Have you touched me?
On our streets.
Let me go, you're on the ground.
In our hospital emergency wards. The lethal cocktail of alcohol and violence.
What's your life like now, Sam? Not very good?
No.
It was a typical busy Saturday night in Coolangatta on Queensland's Gold Coast. 18-year-old Sam Ford was walking to a nightclub with his girlfriend.
Sam was actually walking to the nightclub to meet me. It was his first time going out clubbing since he turned 18.
Sam and his girlfriend heard a male voice from behind and he was yelling abuse towards him, trying to entice Sam to fight him.
Sam was trying to avoid a fight at any cost. He was trying to protect his girlfriend.
Sam was backing away from the incident, trying to text on his phone to his brother to tell him what was going on.
Sam's girlfriend tried to shield Sam and was knocked to the ground.
This man swung wildly at Sam.
The punch was so forceful when Sam's head hit the ground, witnesses said it sounded like a log cracking open.
A crowd quickly gathered. These scenes were captured on a mobile. Several people rang 000.
Hey, can we please get someone as soon as possible out on Greenmount Beach? The guy just got knocked out on the road and he's, I think he's having a fit. He's snorting and,
Oh my God. What I need you to do is actually wait the ambulance down when they get there. I'm going to let them know where you are.
There is actually now about, I'm saying probably 15 to 17 teenagers. It's not looking good.
Sam's brother Ryland came, got there after he received the text, and found Sam on the ground.
I got on the phone. I was actually yelling a bit. Someone call an ambulance. I made a call myself.
There's Sam's girlfriend screaming, people yelling, running everywhere, and all he could do was hold Sam in his lap while they waited for an ambulance to come.
I just remember leaning over him and just holding the sides of his head gently and just continuously talking to him. You know, Sammy, can you hear me? I'm trying to get any response. I'm here. You know, blink your eyes, just let me know you can hear me. There's nothing.
Still clearly intoxicated, the attacker returned to the scene of the crime and was confronted by Sam's friends.
Stop, stop. It's a bloke who's just committed a crime. He's coming back to the scene now. It's not pretty, OK?
We actually have some police here as well.
Yep, we'll need to get the ambulance there first. If you can just move away from the noise so I can actually talk to you.
She hasn't done anything for 20 minutes.
The attacker had drunk 10 cans of bourbon and coke that night. Obviously was heavily intoxicated when the attack happened.
Sam was rushed to Tweed Heads Hospital in a critical condition with a fractured skull and massive brain damage.
I could only look through the doors of the emergency and I could see he was obviously unconscious. He looked a mess. He looked... He looked dead.
It was horrific. I had no idea that it was going to be as bad as what it was. He was covered in blood and vomit and his ears were bleeding.
The doctor said Sam wouldn't make it through the night. They said he needed emergency surgery, that his skull would have to be opened to relieve the swelling.
We were taken into a small room where we just had to sit and wait. Pray.
We had to sign a release to say that they wouldn't revive him if it got to a certain point because it was virtually pointless. That's probably the hardest thing I've ever done.
It is unlikely that the attack on Sam would have happened without vast quantities of alcohol. Police, paramedics and trauma doctors across the country are frustrated and tired of alcohol-fueled violence. Tonight we're on the front line with Sydney's Rocks Police.
Those people have to know that what they are doing is going to do some sort of damage. I don't care how drunk they are.
Sometimes in the heat of the moment, I don't think they're thinking, you know? They've had that much alcohol.
Where's your ID? Get your wallet out.
Police say about 70% of their street work is taken up with alcohol-related cases.
Get your ID out. We've asked you three times.
Some of it petty, much of it not.
I'm Katie, this is Shane, we're from the Rocks Police. All right, you approached us before, kept asking us for this home, we asked you to leave.
Yes.
Now you're back?
Yes, and
okay.
I'm trying to help you. The guy over there is trying to argue with me, he's trying to fight with me over there, because he's drunk.
Maybe you started it, Samuel.
I started it.
Maybe. Please go and get a taxi, please.
Please.
I think it's part of the Australian culture to go out and have a drink. It's just knowing when to stop, when enough's enough. And people at the moment, they don't know it. And they keep going and keep going.
Why do you care about a drunk person?
And a lot of times when we turn up to jobs, people that are that incoherent, they don't even know where they are. And I think a lot of the onus has to be put on licensed premises as well. They need to be more vigilant. They need to be standing in there and looking at who they're serving.
The most frustrating and probably distressing thing is when you get up in the morning and you read the reports and you realise that some of your officers have been hurt, and they've been hurt by someone who is so drunk that they couldn't exercise proper judgment in what they were doing. It's unnecessary, it's unacceptable.
The night of October 10, 2009 has also changed another young man's life. The day after the attack, police arrested 18-year-old Damien Ford, no relation. He was jailed for 6 years and 9 months, but with good behaviour, served only two. Damien Ford was a promising local footballer whose life changed forever in a moment of drunken rage.
So how long have you been diabetic now?
Since I was 10, so 8 years.
In his record of interview, Damien Ford told police that Sam didn't attempt to throw even a punch.
I don't really like drinking that much because stupid stuff happens.
Yep.
There's no excuse, drunk or not drunk. There's no excuse for picking someone out in the street and just going after them. What is that? I don't understand that violent action.
I've seen on the news about the guy that got punched and died from it, I think.
It wasn't the first time Damien had been drunk and angry.
Because I've been in a few fights before and knocked a couple of guys out cold, and I've always been scared that I was going to hurt someone too much, like from someone trying to fight me. I wish I didn't do it, really. I don't know, like, I've always been brought up just to look after myself and never really, if someone comes at me, never back down.
There's nothing I can do. I could go out and kill this guy, I mean, really. And what would that do? It won't help Sam. We have to live with it, and so does he.
Living with it has been challenging for Damien Ford and his family.
He's learnt a very hard lesson. He just wants to try and move on the best he can.
Why did he want you to talk?
He wants to let people know his remorse. He is sorry.
If he could do it himself, he would. But obviously he can't, but he wants everyone to know that what he's done never intended, and he's really sorry about it.
And it was wrong?
It was wrong. And he feels sorry about it for the rest of his life now, so.
The devastating effects of alcohol-fuelled violence is something that New South Wales Chief Magistrate Graham Henson sees every day.
This offence, the charge of affray, carries a maximum jail sentence of 10 years imprisonment.
He allowed Four Corners into his court, where he is sentencing a 22-year-old man who admits, along with three other men, to attacking a stranger in the city.
Although he doesn't recall very much of the incident, he doesn't want to use his intoxication as an excuse for what has happened, and he's truly remorseful of what he's done. And
well, tell me why, Mr. Kwan, he shouldn't be sent to jail today.
This is his first offence, and...
Well, you don't get one free go. The police couldn't even interview you because you were so drunk. And then without reason, without cause, setting upon some other innocent member of the community, knocking them to the ground, stomping on their head in company with three or four other people, causing the person sufficient injuries for them to be carried away to hospital. Now, the prevalence of violence within the community, particularly upon our streets, where it's alcohol-related violence, has reached such epidemic proportions, and the consequences of such violence in terms of injury upon people within the community has reached such a stage that society, and rightly so, is fed up with people such as yourself and your colleagues. You're convicted, sentenced to imprisonment.
The student was sentenced to 9 months in prison and will be eligible for parole after four. Contact
corrective services. 15, 20 years ago, common act of this nature would be one punch and then people would walk away or run away, as the case may be. Now the violence tends to be ongoing. It tends to involve knocking people to the ground. It tends to involve kicking and stamping on somebody who's curled in a fetal position on the ground. What possesses somebody to do something such as that? I don't know. I think what happens now is there are more people out for a longer period of time in licensed premises, so that the potentiality from people right across the social spectrum to be involved in alcohol-related crime is increased correspondingly.
There is a growing body of research that shows people who drink a lot are more likely to end up in the court system. John Eyre sees the links between violence and brain damage from alcohol abuse every day at Arbius, an organisation that looks after people with an acquired...
The injury or the damage to the brain is such that a person progressively and insidiously over time loses the ability normally to be able to make those sorts of decisions that would have you walk away from a confrontation, for example. In fact, you'll do the opposite. You'll engage in it.
You're under arrest for assault. You don't have to say or do anything you wish to do so.
You'll face assault. You will assault. You will have falls. You will find yourself with a brain injury as a result of long-term use of alcohol. There's too much evidence on this that verifies.
A large number of John Eyre's clients have a brain injury from binge drinking. And the concerning news is that they are getting younger.
We're now seeing people who are aged between 20 and 30, which is a significant drop, suggesting people in that age group are drinking far too much, far too much.
Just booze tonight? No drugs?
But the powerful lobby group, the Australian Hotels Association, claims it's drugs mixed with alcohol which is causing most of the problems.
Beer, spirits?
You're not going to like it, but drugs is an issue. You just have to look at the mixing of drugs and alcohol as causing problems.
What evidence do you have for that?
Well, I don't have to see. You just have to pick up the newspapers. You just have to look on radio. No one has done any full-on research when it comes to the mixing of alcohol and drugs.
So no evidence?
No evidence.
There's been claims that increased violence is really not about alcohol. It's caused mostly by illicit drugs.
Well, I think that claim was made by the Hotels Association, I think. That's just, as I said at the time, ludicrous. It may be that illicit drugs are part of the problem, but they are not the problem itself.
Drugs are a major problem.
The Chief Magistrate is saying that's a ludicrous argument and that alcohol is the major problem.
Well, I'd like to see the Chief Magistrate's statistics.
What responsibility should the AHA and the liquor industry take for the amount of alcohol-related crime and injury?
Well, I think they should take more responsibility than what they're taking at the present time.
No wheelchair today?
No, not anymore.
All gone.
Neurosurgeon Brian Aller is the head of the New South Wales branch of the Australian Medical Association.
I mean, you've done amazingly well.
His association has joined forces with police, hospitals, nurses, paramedics and universities.
Okay.
They want new restrictions on the availability, price, sale and promotion of alcohol, which is more affordable and more available than ever before.
The severity of the violent attacks has been on the increase. Now, the number of glassings that we see these days and the number of severe head injuries, the types of kin hits that we never used to see before, have been on the rise for the past few years, and so that's a real worry.
And what happened to you tonight, Steve?
Just got glassed.
Oh, God.
It's Saturday night and Stephen Mitchell is in St Vincent's Hospital emergency in Sydney.
Got some scissors, or grab my scissors.
Stephen was having a few drinks at the Sydney Star Casino when an argument broke out with some other men.
It was just a group of them, kind of had a bit of a disagreement about a chair. And I told him, like, you know, don't worry about it. And then, boom, one of his mates hit me with a glass. So he was supposed to go across the night, but I thought, I'll give it a miss, you know, too many drunk people out. I went to the casino instead, thinking it would be a bit safer, but obviously not.
It's not the sort of thing you expect to happen on a Saturday night.
You expect it whenever you go out these days. You don't expect it to happen to you, but you expect it.
The vast majority of people brought into Sydney's St Vincent's Hospital this Saturday night are heavily intoxicated.
Whoa, you can't walk. That's why you were falling up the stairs.
I know, I'm at the hospital. We can't leave, like, in the next hour.
Thank you so much.
A man is rushed in after reports that he had been attacked by a group at a city bus stop.
Yeah, he's had a fair bit to drink. He thinks he's okay, so he's, in terms of his, you know, of his broken nose there, he thinks he's fine, he wants to go home, so he does need some medical attention, and they're quite intoxicated, so he needs to be here. Nothing too serious problems with it.
But as the night moves on, things do become serious.
Don't touch her. You've got no right to touch her. No. I know the law, mate.
John, who is still very drunk, is caught by security guards trying to escape.
Just relax, boys, mate. Go home and watch Neighbours. Can you stand fucking with me? Don't touch me like that, mate. Oh, you don't scare me, bro. Come on, man. What are you doing, man? What the fuck is that, bro?
By far and away, alcohol is the biggest offender when it comes to these sorts of violent incidents that occur within the hospitals, particularly in our emergency departments.
I can't breathe!
I think if you talk to any doctor and nurse in an emergency department, I think you'd find, be very difficult to find one that hadn't directly experienced alcohol-related violence on a regular basis.
My neck's sore.
As the situation escalates, Four Corners is told to turn off its cameras.
You've got no fucking right to touch me.
John's blood is clean from the hospital floor.
I haven't seen it quite as bad as this, to be honest, but...
The security guards are covered in blood too. And this is just a typical Saturday night in Australia for many emergency departments.
It's a society problem. If you just look at just recently, you've had a number of house parties where people are consuming alcohol at their home, where they've had to call in extra police because the police are being bashed or things being thrown at them. We believe that it is a society problem. We need to be looking and working together with society to resolve the problems of alcohol and drugs that are in our community.
OK, why is there so much alcohol-fuelled violence, in your opinion?
Well, there isn't.
Back in emergency, things have gotten even worse for assault victim John, who had to be physically restrained earlier.
If you're very aggressive and the staff are at risk of being injured, the safest thing to do is to be intubated and paralysed. So unfortunately for this chap, during that process, he vomited and inhaled his own vomit.
After a breathing tube is inserted, John is sent to the hospital's intensive care unit.
Is the country facing a crisis?
We're not facing crisis, we're in a crisis. It's occurring right now. It costs the community over $15 billion a year. But that's not even the ripple effect. Well, what about the families that have to deal with the aftermath?
No.
Use your legs.
Come on. That's it.
I think we've been in a crisis for a long time.
Appears to be intoxicated female.
And when you see 70,000 cases of alcohol-related assaults, 24,000 cases of alcohol-related domestic violence and 20,000 cases of alcohol-related substantiated cases of child abuse. Australian society has a crisis with harmful effects of alcohol.
Oh, so it's on the base of the brain?
Yeah.
OK.
Professor Foe is called to see yet another assault victim back in the emergency department. There's been a drunken brawl in the city. One man was stabbed.
That's good, that's good.
And this man was punched and kicked to the head before losing consciousness.
And do you know what year it is? No. OK. Have you been kicked there? Yeah, OK.
Doctors have to wait until this man and his friends sober up before possibly operating. While assault rates in some states are falling, the injuries are becoming more serious.
And what we're finding is the numbers haven't increased, but their length of stay has, which indicates the severity of the injuries has increased.
Back in 2008 in Newcastle, local police and residents lobbied for a mandatory trial to help combat alcohol-fuelled violence. Most hotels were forced to close at 3:30 a.m. rather than 5 a.m. Lockouts were introduced after 1:30 a.m. and there was a ban on shots and doubles after 10 p.m. This resulted in a 37% drop in assaults.
No, Mozzie? No. Mozzie or no, Mozzie?
You sing your song?
The challenge is to take action now and stop any more horrific attacks like the one on Sam Ford.
He knows how he wants to respond, but he just can't. He's just trapped in the body that he can't use. He knows exactly what's happening, but he just can't respond to it.
Oh, a bit more enthusiasm, buddy.
And it's not just Sam that has to live with the devastating results of alcohol-fueled violence. That night had a terrible ripple effect on the whole family.
Dad actually asked us not to go out that night, and we still did. It's hard. Had we not gone out that night, it wouldn't have happened. We wouldn't be in the situation we're in. I blamed myself for it for a long time, but you got to stop that. Move on.
What movies have we got? What movie do you want to watch?
Like the rest of his family, Ryland has struggled.
I felt depressed and I was at rock bottom. It was a real grind just getting through the day. I mean, I just had, at work, just photos and photos I just stare at for half the day. Old footage from when we'd go on holidays and stuff. And just watch it over and over.
Put your arm up.
Sam's youngest brother, Joel, was 16 at the time of the attack and about to start year 12.
At my worst, I just shut down completely, basically. And every time I'd try and do some work, I'd just pick up the pen and all I could see in my head was Sam. So I was just, like, writing his initials, just SJF and all that.
Where were you writing his initials?
Just, like, on my hand, on my legs, like, just where I've had free skin. Some days I was coming home from school and Mum was upset because I had my, well, I'd just drawn on myself all day, like, up my arms and up my legs.
My moustache just fell off. Didn't want to be there anymore. Too much of it.
Joel did badly in his HSC, but blames no one, especially not Sam.
Gently.
Oh, gently. Words can't even describe how much I love Sam.
He's gonna jump, he's getting ready.
Is everything in our lives.
Do you reckon you can make it?
No.
Normally, like, brothers fight and brothers do all these things, but it takes, like, something like this to realise how much you actually do love him and how much you actually, enjoy his company. Sorry.
Like Joel, Margaret and Michael have battled depression.
I still wake up every morning and wish it hadn't happened, and I wake up sort of thinking, oh, my God, it wasn't a dream. And I feel really, really sad first thing in the morning, and I just wish I could take it away. If I could take over the injury, I would, you know, in a split second. I struggle all the time. Some days it's really hard. You just have to pick yourself up. And we pick each other up because we all struggle. roller coaster. You've just got to keep picking yourself up and you just got to keep saying, I'm doing this for Sam. I'm doing this so he can get back. Get the beds. Get the beds.
Any changes to the liquor laws in Australia will come too late for Sam and his family.
What's your life like now, Sam? Not very good?
No.
And Sam, what's the message for other young people thinking of drinking and going and punching people? What would you say to them?
No.
It's devastating, isn't it? Devastating to lives like yours.